Good morning and welcome to worship. It's great to be able to share with each other this morning. And our first song is one that, if you know it, you probably learnt it as a child in Sunday school. But it's based on a great passage of scripture, a passage that challenges each one of us to live out our faith, to take our stand for the kingdom and for its values. And so this morning, accompanied by Upper Norwood Band, here we go. Dare to be a Daniel. Enjoyed that song this morning, and I picked that in particular because before lockdown in Bible study we were looking at the book of Daniel, and we were reminded how he, along with the other young Israelites, had been taken into captivity in Babylon. And so I thought we could just maybe have a look today at how Daniel in particular coped with his situation. Now, most of us know the story, don't we, that while they were in captivity, King Nebuchadnezzar had this huge statue built, and he told everyone that they had to bow down to this effigy, and if they didn't, then they would be thrown into the fiery furnace. Nice chap. Well, of course, that created a problem, didn't it, for these good Jewish boys, because their faith was built on the Ten Commandments. And we read in Exodus 20 that God said to the people of Israel, "I am the Lord your God, the one who brought you out of Egypt where you were slaves. Do not worship any god except me." And so in making this decree, we see that King Nebuchadnezzar was actually challenging the basis of the Jewish faith. They served the one true God who created all things. And they were committed to following him. But that commitment was about to get them into serious trouble. And then if we fast forward to chapter 6, we see another familiar story which calls for great faith. Daniel is personally faced with a challenge to his faith. Will he stand firm? Let's see.
Chapter 6. It pleased Darius to appoint 120 satraps to rule throughout the kingdom, with three administrators over them, one of whom was Daniel. The satraps were made accountable to them so that the king might not suffer loss. Now Daniel so distinguished himself among the administrators and the satraps by his exceptional qualities that the king planned to set him over the whole kingdom. At this, the administrators and the satraps tried to find grounds for charges against Daniel in his conduct of government affairs, but they were unable to do so. They could find no corruption in him because he was trustworthy and neither corrupt nor negligent. Finally, these men said,
"We will never find any basis for charges against this man Daniel unless it has something to do with the law of his God."
So these administrators and satraps went as a group to the king and said,
"May King Darius live forever. The royal administrators, prefects, satraps, advisors, and governors have all agreed that the king should issue an edict and enforce the decree that anyone who prays to any god or human being during the next 30 days, except to you, your majesty, shall be thrown into the lion's den. Now, your majesty, issue the decree and put it in writing so that it cannot be altered in accordance with the law of the Medes and Persians, which cannot be repealed."
So King Darius put the decree in writing. Now when Daniel learned that the decree had been published, he went home to his upstairs room where the windows opened toward Jerusalem. 3 times a day he got down on his knees and prayed, giving thanks to his God, just as he had done before. Then these men went as a group and found Daniel praying and asking God for help. So they went to the king and spoke to him about his royal decree.
"Did you not publish a decree that during the next 30 days, anyone who prays to any god or human being except to you, your majesty, would be thrown into the lion's den?"
The king answered,
"The decree stands in accordance with the law of the Medes and Persians, which cannot be repealed."
Then they said to the king,
"Daniel, who is one of the exiles from Judah, pays no attention to you, your majesty, or to the decree you put in writing. He still prays 3 times a day."
When the king heard this, he was greatly distressed. He was determined to rescue Daniel and made every effort until sundown to save him. Then the men went as a group to King Darius and said to him,
"Remember, your majesty, that according to the law of the Medes and Persians, no decree or edict that the king issues can be changed."
So the king gave the order, and they brought Daniel and threw him into the lion's den. The king said to Daniel,
"May your God, whom you serve continually, rescue you."
A stone was brought and placed over the mouth of the den, and the king sealed it with his own signet ring and with the rings of his nobles, so that Daniel's situation might not be changed. Then the king returned to his palace and spent the night without eating and without any entertainment being brought to him, and he could not sleep. At the first light of dawn, the king got up and hurried to the lion's den. When he came near the den, he called to Daniel in an anguished voice,
"Daniel, servant of the living God, has your God, whom you serve continually, been able to rescue you from the lions?"
Daniel answered,
"May the king live forever. My God sent his angel, and he shut the mouths of the lions. They have not hurt me, because I was found innocent in his sight. Nor have I ever done any wrong before you, your majesty."
The king was overjoyed and gave orders to lift Daniel out of the den. And when Daniel was lifted from the den, no wound was found on him, because he had trusted in his God.
What a great story of courage and commitment that is, isn't it? Daniel, the captive Jew, heading up the whole kingdom for King Darius. How on earth did he manage that? How did Daniel excel in a social and spiritual environment where the majority of his countrymen were content with the status quo? How did Daniel prepare to face the lions? Well, I think we can see that Daniel's success, both in terms of his standing in the community and his standing in his faith, can be traced to 3 important decisions, and decisions which each one of us face at times in our lives. So are we ready to face the lion's den? Before we look at how Daniel rose to the challenge of facing the lion's den, let's watch a video, and this video reminds us what faith can do.
Everybody falls sometimes, gotta find the strength to rise from the ashes and make a new beginning. Can feel the ache, you think it's more than you can take, but you're stronger, stronger than you know. Don't you give up now, the sun will soon be shining. They gotta face the clouds to find the silver lining. That's what faith can do. It doesn't matter what you've heard. Impossible is not a word. It's just a reason for someone not to try. Everybody's scared to death when they decide to take that step out on the water, but it'll be alright. Life is so much more than what your eyes are seeing. You will find your way if you keep believing.
Prepare to face the lion's den. Well, for Daniel, it all began when he first decided to follow God. Because Daniel was committed to living for God in his private life, he was then entrusted with responsibility in his public life. Daniel became a man of integrity, honesty, and faithfulness by making good and God-honoring decisions. So what decisions then did Daniel make that maybe can help us in our journey of faith? Well, the first thing we see is that Daniel chose character over comfort. As we look at Daniel's life, we see that in a short period of time, Daniel developed a reputation for being honourable and ethical. He did what was right. And because of that, the king put him in charge of the whole kingdom. If we want to do great things for God, we need to be faithful in the small everyday tasks that he asks us to do. So because of how he lived his life, putting character before comfort, the king put Daniel in charge of the whole kingdom. But when the other supervisors and the officials heard about this, this is what we read, they were very jealous. They tried to find reason to accuse Daniel. So they watched what Daniel did as he went about doing the business of the government. But they could not find anything wrong with him. So they couldn't accuse him of doing anything wrong. Daniel was a man people could trust. He did not cheat the king and he worked very hard. Finally, they said, "We will never find any reason to accuse Daniel of doing something wrong, so we must find something to complain about that is connected to the law of his God." As hard as they looked, they couldn't find any skeletons in Daniel's cupboard. Why? Because he chose character over comfort, and even his enemies found him trustworthy. Unfortunately, we are living in a time when it's easy to compromise. Integrity, that quality of being honest and having the strong moral principles, has been in the dock, hasn't it? With all sorts of people being guilty. Politicians, police, TV personalities. But you know, it's not just the rich and famous, is it, that can be tempted to compromise their integrity. Have we never been tempted to tell what we may call a white lie to get ourselves out of a tricky situation? Or been tempted to share the gossip when someone's upset us? Have we never retaliated in anger to get our point across? It is so easy, isn't it, to compromise our integrity when this type of behaviour has become accepted as the norm. Well, that's what happened in Daniel's day. He was faced with compromising what he knew to be right in order to make life easier for himself. Are we never tempted to do that? Well, you know, as Christians, compromising our faith won't actually make life easier. Because what it will do is it will make us uncomfortable, because it will affect our relationship with God. How did Daniel prepare for that day when he would have to face his lions? He made good decisions in everyday living. He chose character over comfort. Daniel was willing to be different from the world around him. Instead of lies and deceit, dishonesty and selfishness, he chose to stand up for his faith. In 2 Peter 1, we read, "Do your best to improve your faith." And you can do this by adding goodness, understanding, self-control, patience, devotion to God, concern for others, and love. If you keep growing in this way, it will show that what you know about our Lord Jesus Christ has made your lives useful and meaningful. But if you don't grow, you are like someone who is nearsighted or blind, and you have forgotten that your past sins are forgiven. As Christians, we should contrast the behaviour of the world rather than compliment it. Unlike many of his contemporaries, Daniel chose character over comfort. He had the courage to be different. Daniel chose character over comfort, but he also chose discipline over disorder. In verse 10 we read, Daniel always prayed to God three times every day. Three times every day he bowed down on his knees to pray and praise God. In life and in our faith, very often the reason that some people seem to succeed while others fail has little to do with our abilities. Very often, our failures can be traced back to an absence of discipline. Athletes know about discipline, don't they? Without disciplined training, they know that they won't be the best that they can be. Now, I ain't going to be running any races anytime soon, but that doesn't mean I don't have to be disciplined. That showing a controlled form of behaviour or that way of working. As Christians, we are called to discipline. Our behaviour should be controlled, but not by our feelings. Our behaviour should be controlled by God's word. I read a statement this week which reminded me of the need to control our tongue. And this is what it said. More people are run down by gossip than cars. More people are run down by gossip than cars. That's a thought, isn't it? Although many people would consider gossip a lesser sin than murder, gossip can kill friendships. It can disrupt families. It can divide a church. And it can assassinate a person's character. As Christians, we need to be disciplined in how we talk. James in his letter speaks about the tongue being a small part of our body, but like a wildfire, it can do a lot of damage. And he goes on to say, we use our tongues to praise our Lord and Father, but then we curse people who were created in God's likeness. These praises and curses come from the same mouth. My brothers and sisters, this should not happen. Daniel chose discipline over disorder. And another area where we need to maintain discipline is in our devotional life, isn't it? You know, as Christians, we don't have the right to complain about the lack of prayer in schools if there's a lack of prayer in our homes. It's all right to defend the Bible in public, but we shouldn't then deny it in the privacy of our own lives. We don't have the right to complain about moral decay in our nation and then fail to pray for our government. Daniel chose discipline over disorder. Three times every day, he got down on his knees and prayed. And what about our church life? How disciplined are we in worship? The discipline of church is important to our spiritual growth. The longer that I travel this journey of faith, the more I realise that I need the church more than the church needs me. I need to be in an atmosphere where my perceptions of life can be challenged. I need to be in an environment that offers an opportunity to learn and also use the gifts that God has given me. Church is the place as Christians that we are accountable for our actions, a place where we can receive wisdom. Church is the place where we are encouraged when we feel like giving up. It's where people pray for us when we are too discouraged to pray for ourselves. And in these days, when we are separated from each other, it is far more important that we are the church, because we need each other for all those things. The discipline of church, of being church, and of meeting together in some way, united by Jesus. How did Daniel prepare to face his lion? He chose discipline over disorder. And when it comes to building the kingdom of God, we need to be disciplined to live in life God's way. We're going to share in a united responsive reading of Psalm 37, which reminds us of some of the areas where we need to be disciplined in our living for God.
Don't worry about the wicked or envy those who do wrong. For like grass, they soon fade away. Like spring flowers, they soon wither.
Let's live God's way.
Trust in the Lord and do good. Then you will live safely in the land and prosper. Take delight in the Lord, and he will give you your heart's desires.
Let's live God's way.
Commit everything you do to the Lord. Trust him and he will help you. He will make your innocence radiate like the dawn, and the justice of your cause will shine like the noonday sun.
Let's live God's way.
Be still in the presence of the Lord and wait patiently for him to act. Don't worry about evil people who prosper or fret about their wicked schemes.
Let's live God's way.
Stop being angry. Turn from your rage. Do not lose your temper. It only leads to harm. For the wicked will be destroyed, but those who trust in the Lord will possess the land.
Let's live God's way. Trust in the Lord and do good. Amen.
Daniel chose character over comfort, discipline over disorder. And finally, Daniel was able to face his lions because he chose love over life. In verse 7, we see that a new law had been issued. No one was allowed to pray for 30 days, and anyone caught doing so would be fed to the lions. Of course, this law was really a smokescreen that was used to get Daniel into trouble. Those who were jealous of him knew that he would never stop praying to God. His love for God was more important than life itself, and his enemies knew that. So they tricked Darius into issuing this new law. Well, when Daniel heard this law, when he heard that it had been declared, what did he do? Well, the Bible tells us, even though Daniel heard about this new law, he still went to his house to pray. He went up to this upper room of his house and opened the windows that faced towards Jerusalem. Then Daniel bowed down on his knees and prayed, just as he always had done. Now, I'm sure at this point, Daniel didn't want to become lunch for a bunch of hungry lions. But when faced with the decision, Daniel chose love over life. His allegiance was to God. Now, I don't think that we will be faced with a lion's den. But is our love for Christ more important than anything else? Is it more important than our own ambitions? Is God more important than the acceptance of our peers? Is Christ more worthy than the pursuit of power or possessions? There's a song we sing, isn't there, which says, I love you more than gold or silver. Only you can satisfy. But do we really mean it? Do we choose love over life? When faced with hard choices, are we motivated by our love for God or our love for an easy life? Jesus himself said, didn't he, that we need to take up our cross and follow him. But that's not easy. And if we are not careful, we can all be guilty of making Christianity a religion of convenience, taking the bits that we like and leaving the rest. Daniel was determined to serve God regardless of the consequences. He chose love for God over a comfortable life. And in verse 23, we see how God honoured Daniel's commitment to him. This is what we read. When Daniel was lifted out of the den, they did not find any injury on his body. The lions did not hurt Daniel because he trusted in his God. As Christians, we are not isolated from painful experiences, are we? There will be times when we won't escape the hard stuff in life. But if we trust in the Lord, he will bring us through those experiences. David knew the benefit of loving God more than the comfort and ease of his own life, didn't he? In Psalm 32 verse 7 he says, you are my hiding place. You will protect me from trouble and surround me with songs of deliverance. How did Daniel keep his faith when the majority of his countrymen were content with the status quo? How did Daniel prepare to face the lions? He chose character over comfort. He chose discipline over disorder. And he chose love over life. And the great news? He will do the same for us if we choose character over comfort, discipline over disorder, and love for God over love for our own lives. As we reflect on the choices that we have to make in our lives, and in particular our Christian life, we are faced with the same challenges, albeit in different ways, as Daniel was. Can we really say, I love you more than anything? Only you will satisfy. Are we prepared to face our lions and remain true to our Lord?
As the deer pants for the water, so my soul longs after you. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship you.
You alone. You're my friend, and you are my brother, even though you are a king.
You're my friend, and you are my brother, even though you are a king. I love you more than any other, so much more than any.
Course again as the deer pants for the water.
Heavenly Father, we thank you this morning for your goodness to each one of us. We thank you for your word. We thank you for the heroes of the faith that we read about there, who are shining examples of how we can live as your people, as bright lights in a dark world. So we pray you will help us as we looked at the life of Daniel to remember that we need to place more importance on character than our own personal comfort. Lord, we need to be disciplined rather than live lives of disorder. And we need to love you more than we love our own personal lives. And so we pray that you will help us as we follow these examples to remember that we depend on you completely for all that we have. We depend on you for power through the Holy Spirit to be able to live a life as Daniel did. Please, Lord, come to each one of us and show us the right way, and then empower us to be your people, to show your love, your kindness, your goodness, and everything that we should be. Help us to show that to the world so that they will be attracted to you. Bless us then, we pray, Father, and keep us strong in you. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Okay, we go out this week and we face whatever is in store for us, but we go in the strength of the Lord. Go do his work, church, choosing character, discipline and love. And we will come out of our lion's den and the glory will all be his. I'll go in the strength of the Lord. God bless you. Have a great week.